So welcome to this episode of TensorFlow Meets, where I'm really delighted to welcome Raziel straight from his talk at the TensorFlow Dev Summit. We spoke all about TensorFlow Lite. Welcome, Raziel. So can you tell us a little bit about you and what you do?
Thank you. I'm an engineer leading TensorFlow Lite. I'm particularly focused on model optimization,
okay,
which is the goal is change the models in certain ways that can be smaller and faster to execute in edge devices.
I see. Okay. Now, I have to say, like, I geek out about TensorFlow Lite. Mm-hmm. If I have a favorite thing in TensorFlow, it's TF Lite. I just love doing it. The demos are always great. And when I do talks, it's usually about that. So it's really kind of fun to have you here, so to learn a little bit more. So
thank you.
Can you tell us what's going on with TensorFlow Lite right now?
Yeah, we are doing a lot of things, right? Like I said in during the talk, we're really trying to make as easily as possible to deploy machine learning on devices. And this is really important because, you know, machine learning is moving from the server to these edge devices. And because of all these characteristics that you have on the edge, it is challenging. So we're trying to make that very, very easy. Mm-hmm. Now, on the flip side, it also means that you have access to a lot of data. It has a strong privacy preserving component. So really, you can build products that otherwise wouldn't be possible if you just rely on server-side execution. Mm-hmm. So the way I see our work is we're enabling the next generation of AI-based applications.
Mm-hmm. Now, to people who may be familiar with TensorFlow Lite, they'll think about it as running on Android or iOS, but you're also extending now into IoT devices.
Yeah, we're extending it to a lot of places. And you know, like the Google Assistant is one example mm-hmm. of that, where you know, if you think the assistant is running on Android, it's running on Google Home devices, but it's also running in many other types of wearables, and they are really trying to push the boundaries of where machine learning can execute, right? Mm-hmm. So we're trying to, you know, engage with them and learn about those use cases and power those. We also have this new project about microcontrollers.
Okay.
So that's also very exciting because we're pushing now more to IoT devices. So again, like we're really trying to push machine learning everywhere.
Yeah. So I mean, one of my favorite scenarios of using it on a mobile device was the cassava. If you've seen that mm-hmm. one, where yeah. it's like these plants and yeah. in Tanzania, and you can like diagnose them for disease by just waving your phone yeah. over them. That yeah. kind of stuff. So that's like it's just a really exciting scenario. Do you see any other good fun scenarios around TensorFlow Lite, or maybe even using it in embedded systems?
Yeah, I mean, like I said, one of the great things of machine learning on the device is that you also do away with these requirements of connectivity, right? Like, yeah. and then this is very important for many different countries that, you know, connectivity perhaps comes at a challenge or is costly. So we're trying to enable all those things, right? And at the same time, we're trying to, you know, support more and more hardware so you can execute better and larger and more complex models on these devices and do even more exciting things with them, right? Like one example is the HTPU. And that's something that we are really, really excited that we support it right now. And we are working with them to make it even better, even faster. Mm-hmm. If you took a look at my presentation, you know, we have this very nice slide of a mobile net. So mm-hmm. mobile net is a very common image mm-hmm. recognition neural network. And you can see the progress from executing in floating point in CPU, which is the baseline, to be able to execute in CPU quantized, then with the GPU support that we have, right? The GPU, right. we're already 7 times faster than what you could get wow. in a regular CPU. And then if you look at the numbers for the HTPU, they are like over 60 times faster, right?
Wow.
And this is really important because the quality of the model, right, is very much directly related to the size and the computation, right? So right. by enabling larger models, then we can also enable better quality for the user.
Excellent. And one of the things you were mentioning there about, like, particularly with complex models like quantization and pruning, mm-hmm. now it used to be that was part of the conversion process mm-hmm. when you're converting to TF Lite, but now you can do it beforehand?
Yeah, we can do it. We can do it before, we can do it after. Each one has its pros and cons, right? Like, the nice thing of beforehand, is that you can get even better quality. So typically with all these techniques, you know, you have a model and then you apply one of these techniques and it might affect your accuracy a little bit. So by doing it at training time, where we're really trying to minimize that loss. Mm-hmm. And in many cases, there is none, right? Mm. Now, then the nice thing is also that, you know, being part of the TensorFlow, we have also Keras, mm-hmm. As this really nice abstraction for neural network layers. So we're building on top of Keras. And if you look at our APIs that are coming very soon, it's extremely easy for anybody to just, you know, if they have already a Keras model, it's very easy to apply quantization or pruning.
Nice.
At the same time, we're making a huge effort also on the post-training side to make it very easy for everybody to also quantize a model, for example. And that's because some people are not very familiar with training or you know, like the first thing that they want to try is they just have a model that they got somewhere and they want to quantize it. Mm-hmm. So that's why we have this other path of doing post-training quantization. So we're very invested in doing both, right? Like power users and somebody that just wants to try it and see how things go.
That makes perfect sense. So if somebody's like really inspired by this and wants to give it a try, how would you recommend they get started?
Well, we have a lot of sites, right? A lot of examples in the TensorFlow org site. We have right now four complete applications that people can try. And we're trying to really build up our model repository. And the goal is that if there is somebody out there that perhaps doesn't have the experience or doesn't want to invest right away, but has a cool idea for a very, very interesting product, they can go to our repository, see what is there, and maybe there is something already that they can take advantage of.
And maybe they can build on that and expand
exactly.
it, and others can learn from their experience.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, I think it's all about, like, you know, making frictionless adoption, right? Yeah. Like, once you feel comfortable doing something, then you can try more complex things or more complex things.
So thanks so much, Raziel. That was, as always, informative and inspiring.
Thank you.
So thanks, everybody, for watching this episode of TensorFlow Meets. If you have any questions for me or any questions for Raziel, just please leave them in the comments below. And I'll also put a link to his talk from the TensorFlow Developer Summit so you can learn a lot more about TensorFlow Lite. So thank you so much.